Kelley, as provinces across the country open up, Canadians are ready to spend on retail, on entertainment, on travel. There is this urge to splurge, if you will. But how do we avoid the pitfalls of debt?
Absolutely, Larysa. And the thing is Canadians are richer than they think. So before we get into that, let me just give you some numbers of how much money we're sitting on. So BMO Capital Markets estimates that Canadians' household net worth rose by $2 trillion during the pandemic. The average household right now has $1 million in total assets, and that's actually accounting for debt. And we're sitting on an estimated $210 billion that was saved in 2020. That was only $18 billion in 2019. So on average, Canadians are sitting around $5,500 in savings. That was just under $500 in 2019. To give you a visual, if we saved a $5 cup of coffee, let's say, in 2019, that would have been 95 cups of coffee we saved. In 2020, 1,115 cups of coffee. So with that kind of money, Canadians feeling richer than they think, yes, there is this explosion of, either spending already, depending where in the country you are, or getting ready to spend. I know anecdotally, I'm hearing from a lot of my friends, from business associates that have already booked trips well into 2022, hair salons, nail salons, saying that when they started to open up or as they're opening up, their websites are crashing because of people, wanting to book these appointments. So definitely we're seeing this need to spend, Larysa. But I'm hoping that we've also learned some lessons as well during the pandemic that we can budget, we can save. It's just a matter of, keeping these learnings moving forward as well.
There is also another side to that. We've also been hearing about Canadians' ability to cover living expenses, rising debt, insolvency. Give us some of the data.
You're so right. It's not all a rosy picture. Obviously, if you had your job, you had your health, you didn't have family or parents to look after, things are rosy. But for so many people, they're not. So MNP came out with their debt index again. And what they found is just about 50% of Canadians are either insolvent or unable to pay their bills over the next 12 months. They've been doing this index, Larysa, since 2017, and they report that things are the worst since they've actually come out with this index. One in four, are worried about rising interest rates. A third are actually house poor. And it's interesting because 5.5 million households, they are saying, are susceptible to any disruptions in interest rate changes, in job changes. And we just saw the numbers today that inflation was above 3%. What does that mean moving forward for interest rates? A lot of people are worried about that. When we talk about homeowners, 20% regret that they took on as much debt as they did. And anecdotally, again, I've talked to a lot of homeowners that feel that just because the bank has approved you for this amount of money, that is the budget that should be for your home. And unfortunately, a lot of them are shocked and surprised at the expenses of home ownership and feel that they are really bogged down with their homes. So not everyone has those dollars to run out and push back into the economy, indeed. And this index, again, is telling us that a lot of Canadians are in fact struggling.
I heard you use the term house poor. What does it mean?
What it means, and it can mean something very different for different people, is really just scraping by to get that home. It still is the Canadian dream, especially if you're buying in Vancouver or Toronto. It's almost guaranteed that the first-time homebuyer is going to be house poor, meaning they probably do not have that robust savings account, the emergency savings account that we know helped a lot of Canadians weather the pandemic. But if you came into the crisis without it, it certainly created a huge cash crunch. You know, you can't eat your countertop. You can't trade in your deck if things are tough. So just getting into your home can be incredibly stressful, and then not realizing all of the costs of home ownership. You know, if the plumbing goes or the roof goes, it's 100% on you to come up with those dollars. So, you know, furnishing that bigger home, maybe you moved from a small condo to a single dwelling that all of a sudden kind of required this massive influx of spending just within your home. And then let's not forget opportunity costs. When you know, take all of your cash flow into a home, that means probably nowhere, little travel, eating out, all those other little luxuries go away, and it can really weigh heavily on homeowners feeling that they're just really poor, house poor, in those original years that they purchased.
Have we been seeing behavioral changes in how we spend money? Has the pandemic highlighted that?
It has indeed. And actually, an organization that I love is BE Works. They really are a brilliant think tank behind a lot of these behavioral issues that we have, which we always have when it comes to money. We think that we're rational. You know, true economists say that we weigh the pros and cons, where behavioral economics says, not so fast. We make a lot of irrational decisions at times. And yes, you're so right, Larysa, the pandemic has shone a spotlight on that. So for example, there's three that really jump out to me from one of their webinars that I was on. First is the scarcity mindset. This, you know, present bias that we have to really look at coming out of the pandemic with, hey, you and your family have been suffering through scarcity. You haven't been able to spend, or you haven't had the money to spend. And now as things are opening up, will you know, not balance that out with your future self, right? Really looking at what is it that you want to do today? What is it that your family has had to forego that you don't care about your future self? So that's a real worry to behavioral economics folks. And, you know, the second one is something that has really grown in popularity over, I think, the last 12, 18 months is buy now, pay later. And I'm seeing it on tons of websites where even small amounts, like you can buy this for $50, or you can just make these easy payments over 4 or 6 months. So now we're not looking at that, you know, that number. We're looking at the small, easy payments that these retailers are breaking out. So that can be very worrisome. Lastly, and they had a whole litany in this webinar, was the intangibility of credit, which credit, again, has always been intangible. When we pay with cash, and we know during the pandemic, less and less individuals were paying with cash, we actually feel a loss. Our brain actually feels a loss when we do that. When we tap and go, we don't feel that tangibility. And then very lastly, Larysa, when you pay your credit card bill at the end of the month, everything's all lumped in. So you don't really have the sting of the individual purchases and that tangibility of what they cost. You're just paying this overall bill, which again can take that pain factor away, which is a good thing if you want to stick to your budget. So all these things are really concerning the behavioral folks, and just being aware of it can help us kind of maybe take a little pregnant pause before we overspend and just think about what it is that we're doing and how it affects our future selves as well.